In step 10, we want to take our prototype back to work in a 50 ohm system. We achieved a lot in the last step. We made sure that our shunt stubs had the right characteristic impedances to be implemented in microstrip, that is between 30 ohms and 80 ohms. But one of the consequences of that was that our source and load impedances became quite high, and so we had to introduce these inverters, 139 ohm inverters. And so what we're going to do is talk about implementing these input and output inverters. In some cases, an inverter can be implemented as a capacitor network. These are equivalent, that is, the inverter here, the impedance inverter here, and this two-port network with capacitors are equivalent only for resistive load, so it's not a general solution. The inverters that we talked about before would work with complex impedances. In fact, they were in the middle of our filter, so those inverters really did see complex impedances. But our inverter now, the one at the input, and also the inverter at the output, they're in a special category. They see 50 ohms on one side, and looking into the core of the filter, they see 389 ohms. But the way we're going to determine what the values of CA and CB are going to be is by equating the admittances of the two circuit with a resistive load. Now, I should say at this time, CA and CB don't have to be both positive. In general, they will not be both positive. So this is not the same as general matching, which works with complex conjugate impedances, but it is the same as matching if the input and output are resistances. So these two circuits are equivalent, but only for resistive loads. In fact, we need to see resistances looking both ways. When we look into the inverter from one side, that is from the external world, we're going to see 50 ohms. But when we look from the inverter out, we're going to see 389 ohms. The element we're designing here, the two-port consisting of those capacitors CA and CB, does look like an inverter. Now let's talk about the design of that capacitive network that implements our inverter. This looks like a matching network, like an LC matching network, but we're going to keep it as capacitors, and we'll see eventually that CA comes out to be a negative value, so it could be an inductor. But we keep it as a capacitor because CA is going to be in parallel with another capacitor, and it makes it easier to combine the two together. Now, this design is the implementation of an inverter. It is only an accurate implementation of an inverter provided that the input and output resistances, that is the source and load resistances, are resistances and there's no reactive component. On the left-hand side here, we have the core of the filter. The core of the filter has an input impedance of 389 ohms looking from both directions. So when we insert our matching network or our inverter network, we want to be able to see an impedance of 389 ohms looking into that network. On the other side, we have our external world, which is in a 50 ohm system. So Yin is going to be the input admittance, 1 over 389 ohms, modified by CA-CB, terminated in RL. Here is our design equation. Yin is going to be equal to RL divided by K squared. That is the description of our inverter. K is the impedance of the impedance inverter. So it's RL divided by K squared, 50 ohms divided by the K value, which is 139.5 ohms squared. That's equal to 1 over the input impedance. And when we do just a little bit of circuit analysis, we end up with that equivalent circuit. After a little bit of manipulation, we first of all arrive at CB and then CA, by equating the real and imaginary parts of the admittance. So here is the prototype from the last step. We're going to keep everything in the middle the same, but we're going to implement the inverters using this capacitive network. And we're going to see that CA and C1 are in parallel. In fact, C1 is a bigger capacitor than CA, so even though CA is negative, putting CA and C1 in parallel is going to give us a positive capacitance. And when we do that, This is the prototype we end up with at the end of this step. We have a capacitor C1, which is now a combination of CA, which came from our inverter realization, and CT1. It is 1.6 picofarads, so C1 is equal to C3. But now, the capacitor in the middle, C2, has its old value of 2.7 picofarads, and CB is 1.22 picofarad. All of these capacitors are very reasonable values of capacitance at 1 GHz. We can use surface mount components to realize them. Our characteristic impedances for the shunt stubs are reasonable as well.